There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song.
Hey, what's up, my peeps? Just want to hook you up with the word this week. Just wanted to also connect, give you some information, just some things that are going about. On Memorial Day, the doors of the church will open. We will have worship. It will be at 10:30. There will be no life groups. We will not have student small groups yet. We will not do midweek activities. So those things are all still on hold until we get the release or the permission be able to engage that way. Then we'll still have to continue doing some of the virtual things that we're doing, such as what we're doing right now. So stay connected, jointed with your life group leaders. I'm hoping and praying that they're connecting with you in a small group way. And if not, pursue them, ask them, hey, can we get together and have a Zoom call? We will eventually here in the next, probably I'd say week or two, even a little bit, maybe just a little bit further than that. We're kind of expecting some information to come towards the end of the month as far as guidelines. We're already venturing into plans for the summer, so I'm kind of developing those ideas and kind of figuring that out, kind of seeing how God's going to map out how we can engage with one another, but continue to stay connected with our Zoom calls during the week. At noon, we do want to take those Zoom calls and launch those into actual small group meets. That's the full expectation that we'll leverage what we've been doing virtually and try and have an opportunity to meet together. So don't let loose of that. I've really enjoyed having you. If you know there's some students, those that are in your life group or those in your friend circle that they're just kind of having a hard time right now. Man, one of the best things they can do is connect with God's people, connect with Jesus as we go through some of these virtual encounters, and love for you to be an advocate, be a ministry agent for the church, for your friends, to invite them and be a part of what God is doing in our student ministry. He's still alive and well, still see a lot of movement, still see a lot of growth. And I think that God is going to really move in our student ministry when we get back. I believe that we are ready to be together. I'm ready to be with you. But as we look to our passage this week, we'll be looking at Matthew 18, and we're looking at this really this journey about struggle of will, struggle of really just looking at, you know, will you surrender to the authority of God's word in this sense? I believe that until you do that, you're not able to accomplish the task that we're going to read about. So we're going to be in Matthew 18, and we're going to be in verse 21. It says this: Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a curtain, a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle his accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold, which his wife and children and all that he had, and the payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of the servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave his debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, Pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. So when the fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him and said to him, "You wretched servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have compassion on your fellow servant, just I had pity on you?" And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you, if to each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Guys, that's a great challenge to encounter this week, that we do not give up on forgiveness, and realizing that we were forgiven by the Master, the ultimate Master, Jesus Christ, but the ultimate Master, God the Father. That if we are to embrace that mercy and that grace and that forgiveness, then we need to give that mercy and grace and forgiveness. It's so easy to receive forgiveness, but I know it's hard to give forgiveness. And really, when it comes to forgiveness, it's not empowering the other person. It's empowering the Christ that's in you to let go of that anger, let go of that hate, let go of that bitterness. Those things are releasing. Those give you freedom because you give those over to Christ. And you trust that because you're forgiven, that you can draw from the strength that Christ gives you to forgive others. And it releases you. It releases you from, I believe, a sin that's in your heart. Because just like this wretched servant that would not forgive his own servant, that the master came to him and said, "You begged me, and I'll let you go. Should you not have forgiven your servant?" So don't find yourself being, quote unquote, a hypocrite. Okay, don't think that you deserve mercy and grace and no one else does. So if there's someone in your life, maybe it's a parent. You know, a lot of times we do that with mom and dad, and they do things that we don't like. They do things that we don't understand, and we are so mad at them. And we really just get to a point where, you know, we're just bitter, and we hold on to that bitterness. I believe that that is an anchor on our soul, and that we need to learn to forgive and to let those things go and trust in God. Trust that God gave us a mom and a dad to be in a place where no matter what example they are to us, that they have provided for us to some level, and that they deserve mercy and grace, not because of anything they've done, but because Christ has forgiven us. So see, if it starts with Christ, then it should end with Christ. It shouldn't be a matter of, do they deserve it? You know, that's a lot of times the question that we have. Well, do they deserve my forgiveness? We don't deserve forgiveness, yet God gave us mercy and grace. That's why it is mercy and grace. So if we receive that mercy and grace as Christians, then we need to impart it on those that are in our life, and be free from that bitterness, from that forgiveness. Maybe it's someone that broke up with you. Maybe it's a brother or sister that just aggravates the snot out of you. Maybe it's a church. Maybe right now you're listening virtually. By God's grace, you're listening to this word, and it finds you in a place where it's challenging you to forgive. And you've been bitter this whole time because no one knows that you're there. No one has reached out to you. You're hurting, and you're just wondering, why is the church not embracing me? Listen, if you're watching this video, the church is touching you. It's reaching out to you saying, hey, we love you. We care enough about you that we're sharing God's word. Whether you know me or not, I'm just telling you this. You can always reach out to the church, and I'll be more than happy to share God's word with you. And I will definitely share mercy and grace with you and help you in your time of need. If there's an opportunity that you need to let go of bitterness and to focus on forgiveness, I'll give you more than this just passage. I'll give you the entire word of God. I'll give you the Bible, and you can dive in for yourself and do that journey with Christ, because I believe it's the beginning of Christ that we're able to forgive other people. I don't believe really and truly that people can earn forgiveness. I believe it's something that we have to give, and we don't give on merit, because if we give on merit, that means if they ever go back on their actions, then we will take that forgiveness back. But when we give forgiveness through the love of Christ, then there are no strings attached. Just like Christ loved us, he took our sin from the east, as far as the east is from the west. The Bible tells us that he forgives and forgets and puts that, wipes that off your docket, so to speak. Does God know the things that you struggle with? Yes, absolutely. Does he know the things that he's forgiven you over? Yes, absolutely. But he does not impart those on you, not because of what you've done, not because how good you've been, not because of how faithful you've been, but because how faithful Christ's been to you. He died on the cross for you. And when he said it was finished, that means your forgiveness was given because sin was no more in your life. So I just love that. I just love the thought of that even as we struggle day to day and we're faced with temptation, that Christ's blood is so powerful that his sins, that his blood covers my sins yesterday, today, and forevermore. So before I even sin today, his blood is already covered. That's how powerful it is. And so I'm thankful for that. But as a Christian, I desire not to sin because I don't want to push those thorns any deeper. I don't want to have that cat of nine tails have to scrape into his flesh that much more because of my sin. And it hurts me to think about the pain that I've caused him to suffer, because even if he died just for me, he would still have to suffer that same death. And I pray that he forgives me. And you know, in my heart, I know that he has, because he said that I willingly, while you were a sinner, I gave my life to for you, because he loves us. He demonstrated that love for us. No greater love than that, than for a friend to lay down his life. And he not only is my friend, he's my Savior, my Lord, and he can be yours as well. So let him be that. Let him take over those situations where you hang on to bitterness. And I pray that forgiveness will not haunt you this week. So, hey, turn into that word and dive into it. That's Matthew 28, 21 through 35. And that's just a great passage for this week, a challenge. Talk to you on Zoom calls this week. And then we'll also have worship 6 o'clock, virtual style. And I look forward to worshiping with you. Love you guys. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.